Hey, good morning. Welcome to Unity East Church service for Sunday, May 30th, 2020. This is the fifth Sunday of the month, and we have with us this morning Anita Koch, and her talk title will be Secure in Spirit. My name is Linda Geibel, and I will be the platform assistant for today. Let us open with prayer. Father, Mother, Everything God, we thank you for this day and thank you for this time we have together for our church service. Let us be a blessing to all who hear it. For all who have challenges in their life, whether it be grieving, sadness, illness, or fear, let them feel the power of your protection, Lord, and your love. We also take a moment to pray for our family and friends who are going through difficulties. Hold them in your loving arms, Lord, and give them peace and protection. Amen. Amen. Our statement of purpose for Unity East Church is to teach the universal principles of truth as taught and demonstrated by Jesus Christ and interpreted by Unity. And our mission statement is to rediscover the guiding spirit of God's presence within us and willingly demonstrate his creative purpose in our lives. The daily word for today is love. And I would like to read it for you. For Sunday, May 31st, I am a loving presence to everyone I meet. It has been said that the world needs more love. The truth is that all the love the world could ever need is already present everywhere, because God is love and God is present everywhere. Created in God's image, I am a divine love and human expression. I know that love is much more than a positive feeling. Divine love is the energy of oneness itself. As I remain centered in divine love, I know oneness in God with all people, including those who are dear to me and those I've never met. Divine love helps me see good everywhere and in everyone. I look beyond conflict and limitation and find the good that is always mine to discover. From 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. So please repeat the affirmation after me. I am a loving presence to everyone I meet. I am a loving presence to everyone I meet. Let us say together our statement of being. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. And we are. Our announcements for this morning is our board is going to meet this Wednesday, and we will be discussing possible opening dates for the church. So please keep the board in prayer that we will make the right decisions for our church. We will keep you informed of any updates, and that's it for the announcements. I would like to introduce Anita Koch, who will be leading us in the Lord's Prayer, meditation, and then her message. She will begin with a song called, I Will Fear No More. Anita.
Every anxious thought steals my breath. It's a heavy weight upon my chest. As I lie awake and wonder what the future will hold, help me to remember that you're in control. You're my courage when I worry in the dead of night. You're my strength 'cause I'm not strong enough to win this fight.
Now it's time for the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, if you will please prepare for meditation. As we enter into this meditation, we bless this time together. And I invite you to sit in a comfortable position with your feet flat on the floor and your hands relaxed in your lap, open to the love and abundance of the universe. Become aware of your breath, breathing deeply and slowly, focusing on your breath as it flows into and out from your body easily and effortlessly. You may want to envision yourself in a beautiful garden. A nearby stream makes soft sounds as it flows over rocks and fallen branches. You feel a gentle breeze against your skin and inhale the scent of the trees and flowers that surround you. As you sit quietly, You feel the complete perfection of life with each breath. As you inhale, you are receiving life, and as you exhale, you are giving life. Open yourself to the power and presence that is the divine essence, the life force that lives and moves in you and through all things. As you relax in this sacred place, you see a soft light in front of you. Continue to breathe slowly and easily, and notice the light becomes brighter. It surrounds you. You feel an energy, a loving presence emanating from that light. It flows into, through, and around your entire being. You feel that divine essence with every breath you take. The gentle, warming warmth of that loving presence fills you, and you know you are completely safe and protected. As your feet rest lightly on the ground, you feel that connection to all of life. Life surrounds you. You breathe in life. You breathe out life. You are life, and life is what you are. It is the essence of you and the essence of all things. There is life in the air, trees, flowers, water. Even the seemingly inanimate objects are teeming with life. As you feel this energy filling every cell of your body, you know you are always connected to this life energy, and it is always connected to you. You know that life is love. You know that God is love. Life is everywhere, in everything and everyone, just as love is everywhere, in everything and everyone. We are overwhelmed with gratitude that we can be together, even virtually. We allow love to guide our thoughts, our feelings, and our actions. And as a result, we are continuing to grow and become happier, more peaceful, and more loving people. And together, we all say, Amen. And now the congregational response together. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord. The title of my talk today is Secure in Spirit. An alternative title that I thought about was Faith Over Fear. And that's why I chose the song that we started with. And I'd like to start by sharing with you a story. These guys right here, these are water buffalo. And this little guy, his name is Adolfo, and this is his daddy. That's La Biba. Now, these animals are considered to be one of the most dangerous in all of Africa. And Adolfo knew this, so he turned to his father and he said, Dad, is there anything I should be afraid of? Labiba looked at him and said, Well, son, there is one thing.
What is it?
Lions, my son. Only lions. Adolfo nodded. Yes, I've never seen one, but I've heard about those lions. The beaver said, and if you see one, what will you do?
Well, if I see a lion, I'm going to turn around and run as fast as I can.
No, cautioned his father. You must not run. That's the worst thing you can do.
What do you mean, Dad? I can't just stay there. The lions will try to kill me.
Adolfo, lions are very fast. If you run away, they will chase you. You will not be able to outrun them, and then they will catch you, and they will jump on your back and bring you down.
So if I can't run, what do I do?
Labiba looked at his son very seriously. If you ever see a lion, you must stand your ground to show them you're not afraid.
But what if he doesn't go away?
Then you lower your head, you show him your sharp horns, and you stomp the ground with your hooves.
But what if he still doesn't go away?
Then it's time for you to be brave. You must move slowly toward him. And if the lion remains, you must charge him with all your might and hit him as hard as you possibly can. Well, little Adolfo couldn't believe what he was hearing.
I can't do that. That's too scary. The lion might attack me back.
Labiba nudged his son. Look around you, Adolfo. Tell me, what do you see? As Adolfo's gaze swept over the plain, he saw a herd of more than 200 massive beasts. Each one was armed with sharp horns and huge shoulders. And this is the wise advice that Adolfo heard. If you're ever afraid, you know you have support. We are here to help you. Don't panic and run from your fears, because if you do, there's nothing we can do to save you. But if you charge toward that which you fear, we will be with you. You see, we all have things that scare us, and it's highly unlikely that will ever change. However, we also always have a choice as to how we respond to those fears. We can run from them, or we can face them. And if we try to run from our fears, like the lions chasing the water buffalo, our fears will chase us and take us down. In the last talk that I gave, I made a statement, feel the fear and do it anyway. Well, that's actually the title of a book. And in the book's introduction, we are advised, rather than being primarily a psychological problem, fear is primarily an educational problem. And by re-educating the mind, you can accept fear as simply a fact of life rather than a barrier. Excuse me. The author then goes on to tell us how she re-educated herself to overcome her own fear of failure. And we can do the same thing. We can re-educate ourselves, and in the process, we can learn to stand secure in spirit. Philippians 4:13 reminds us, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Just like Adolfo, we're not alone. We have the greatest power in the universe backing us up. And we know God is good all the time. Infinite Spirit lives in us. It's our constant companion. The Father and I are one. We're told that
in John 10:30. We have an internal guidance, a GPS, God's powerful spirit. It will never let us down, and it will always lead us in the right direction. All we need to do is ask for help. Ask and it is given. Seek and you will find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Let's not allow fear to hold us back. After all, what is fear anyway? It's a feeling. It's an emotion. I've heard it said that fear is false evidence appearing real. And you know what it is about fear? Every time we feel that emotion, the underlying belief behind it is we just don't think we can handle it. What if I get sick? What if I don't get the job or I lose my job? What if I run out of money? What if I make a mistake and I end up looking like a fool? We're afraid that if any of those things won't happen, if any of those things happen to us, we just won't be able to handle it. And it doesn't matter what it is. In each and every one of these cases, we're allowing that false evidence to appear real. The truth is, when we remain secure in spirit, we can handle it, whatever it is. We just don't give ourselves enough credit. We are way more capable than we know. For most of his life, George had a fear of flying. Every time he even thought about it, he would just get scared to death. When asked about his reluctance to get on an airplane, his reply was something like this. Well, I think about all the plane crashes I heard about in the news. I start shaking and sweating, and next thing I know, I'd have a pounding headache. I mean, to be honest, I reached the point where I'm pretty much giving up on traveling completely. Sure, there were things that George missed, things his fear kept him from doing, like when his favorite nephew got married, George made up an excuse why he couldn't come to the wedding. Then there was the work conference that he really wanted to attend, but in the end, he feigned an illness to avoid having to go. It wasn't until he got married and then had children that it all came to a head. Like most kids, George's son and daughter wanted to go to Disney World. His wife was open to the idea, and so was George, except for this one little glitch. See, George and his family lived here in Michigan, and they only had a week for their family vacation. Well, the only way they were going to get to Disney and back in the amount of time they had was to fly. So after years of brushing it under the rug, George decided it was time to face his fear. Now, he'd tried to do it on his own in the past, but this time he sought professional help. And the therapist helped George take a closer look at his thoughts about flying. And after talking about it for a long time, George realized that his fears had become very exaggerated. Together, he and his counselor looked at the statistics, and George learned he was 200 times more likely to be in a fatal car accident than in an airplane. In fact, the odds of being in a plane crash were one in every 1.2 million flights. And actually dying in a plane crash increased the odds to one in 11 million. He had a better chance of winning the lottery. So George also learned skills that would help him when he was flying or anytime he was anxious. He learned meditation and visualization techniques. He practiced focusing on his breath, slowing it down, breathing deeply and evenly. He even memorized some Bible verses. Isaiah 41:10, "Do not fear, for I am with you. 2 Timothy 1:7, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and of love. Philippians 4:6, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, and with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. When it was time for that much anticipated vacation with his family, George was able to face his fear. When the flight took off, he focused on his breathing, keeping it calm and even. If thoughts about crashing tried to creep into his mind, he'd repeat the Bible verses he memorized. Then he'd visualize how much fun they were all going to have. Anytime he felt himself getting anxious, he'd just close his eyes and picture the kids laughing and enjoying themselves. And by the time they landed, he was practically grinning from ear to ear. He was so proud of himself. He'd done it. Knowing he was able to handle this first airplane flight made him feel confident that if he could handle that, he could handle just about anything that came his way from then on. They say when the student is ready, the teacher appears. Now that teacher might be a therapist, a book, an online class, even a church service. When we're open, when we're willing, all we have to do is remain secure in spirit. Be still and know the help we need is only a heartbeat away. God's powerful spirit, our GPS, is built in to each and every one of us. All we need to do is look inside and say, help. Hello, eternal loving spirit. Remain secure in spirit. Remember that eternal loving presence is always there for you. It knows what we need and when we need it. Our job is to listen and trust. We need to have faith. God is all, both invisible and visible. We just said that. We say that every week. And we know that God is love, an eternal loving presence. The power that made the universe loves you. There is nothing you need to do and nothing you have ever done that could make you any more loved than you are right now. And there was never a time, not for 1 second, that the unending, infinite love was ever withheld or even diminished a tiny bit. The love of spirit is unconditional. You've always been loved and will always be loved. Nothing you have ever done, nothing that has ever happened to you has diminished it even one iota. You are so very dearly loved. If you're holding on to anything, if there's even a glimmer of a thought in your mind that you're not deserving of divine love, I want you to pull it out. Grab hold of that thought and yank it out like you would a stubborn weed. Know you are loved. You are lovable. Be open to receive all the love and all the blessings you so richly deserve. And remember what it says in 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. And 2 Timothy 1:7 tells us, for God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. We have an innate, divine, given power. We have the power to control our thoughts. When George got on that airplane for the first time, he took that power and he made a choice. He chose to use the tools he'd been given and to focus his thoughts on the Bible passages he'd memorized. He chose to visualize how much fun his family was going to have together. He chose to focus on the good. In Deuteronomy 30, Moses speaks to Joshua, who is to follow in Moses' footsteps and then lead the people of Israel. In verse 19, Moses said, "I call on heaven and earth as witnesses today that I have offered you life or death, blessings or curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants will live." Every minute of every day, we're making choices. Some are big, some are small. And one of the greatest realizations we can come to is to understand that power we have to choose. When we have control, even when we don't have control actually over what's happening, we still have the power to choose how we'll respond. Every minute of every day, we can choose to believe we are loved, believe we are protected and cared for, believe the words that say, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me," or we can choose to worry. We can worry about this pandemic. We can worry about our finances, our health, whatever. I want you to ask yourself, are the choices you're making helping you? Are they empowering you? Are they making you feel good about yourself and about others or not? Those choices are determining the direction of your life. You are choosing to stand secure in spirit, or you're choosing fear over faith. Neither fear nor faith can be seen. They're simply feelings, nothing more. Nothing more than thoughts, nothing more than emotions. When you're secure in spirit and you sneeze, you might tell yourself, it's just my allergies acting up. But if you're choosing fear over faith, that same sneeze might whisper dire warnings of a fatal disease. When you're secure in spirit and your place of work is closed temporarily, you'll smile, remind yourself how grateful you are because you know you have a source that no temporary shutdown can close. If you're choosing fear over faith, that temporary closure might cause you to lose sleep at night and worry about paying your bills. If you're choosing fear over faith, that means you're looking back and telling yourself that there are things that you can never escape, things that are never going to change, that'll never get better. But when you're secure in spirit, you can look at what's happened in your past and know it's in the past. None of that matters. You are loved. You are blessed. Your future is bright with promise. And remind yourself, I love this one, this hangs on my wall. The past is history. The future is a mystery. The moment, right now, today, is a gift. And that's why we call it the present. Mark 9, 1826 tells us a story of Jairus. Now, Jairus was a Jewish leader, and he came to Jesus because he had a 12-year-old daughter who was very ill, actually on the verge of death. His wife, Jairus's wife, had heard about what Jesus had been doing and healing people, and she went to her husband, and she asked him to go to Jesus for help. But because Jairus had this leadership position in the synagogue, and he was very prominent, He was reluctant to grant the request that his wife had. He didn't want to ask help from the person who was actually questioning the authority of the very group of Jewish leaders he was a member. But his wife had heard about how Jesus had healed the child of a Roman soldier in Cana of Galilee, and how he healed the servant of a centurion in Capernaum. Day after day, she kept after her husband until finally she just got down on her knees and begged, "If you don't go, our daughter will surely die." Jairus knew that what his wife was saying was true, and it seemed like he just didn't have a choice. There were no other options, so he went. And when Jairus saw Jesus, he threw himself down at Jesus' feet. And he was begging, pleading with Jesus, "Please come and lay your hand on my little girl. I know if you do, she will be healed." But before Jesus could even acknowledge Jairus, somebody else, a woman, touched the hem of Jesus' cloak, and she drew Jesus' attention away. And it was while Jesus was helping this other woman that some people from Jairus' home arrived, and they told the Jewish leader that it was too late anyway. His daughter had already passed. Well, Jairus' heart was absolutely broken. He just broke down in tears. He lost his precious child. But Jesus had overheard the conversation, and he saw the anguish of Jairus, and he said to him, "Be not afraid, only believe." Jesus then took his disciples Peter, James, and John with him, and they went to Jairus' home. And while Jairus and his wife and everyone else watched, Jesus took the little girl's hand, the little deceased girl, and said, "Child, arise." And to everyone's amazement, that little girl sat up and stood next to her bed. Just think about the words that Jesus spoke. Be not afraid, only believe. Remain secure in spirit. No divine being can make a way. Even when it looks like there is no way, it may look like it's impossible, but we know it says in Matthew 19:26, with God, all things are possible. Fear can keep people in unrewarding jobs, careers, unhappy relationships. It can hold them back from their good. They tell themselves, "Yeah, things aren't great, but it could be worse, right?" Even though there's pain, it's a familiar pain. Fear can keep us in very uncomfortable comfort zones. I mean, sometimes we just get caught up in those what ifs. What if I leave my abusive spouse and end up alone with no way to support myself? What if I quit my safe, secure, but oh, so boring job that I hate and start a business and I fail? What if I try and end up making a fool of myself and everybody laughs at me? What if I take the other job and I don't like it? What if, what if, what if? Fear can keep us from our growth, from our good. The past, or even what's happening today, does not determine the future. There are going to be times in all of our lives when we come face to face with fear. And when we do, we have two choices. We can forget everything and run, or we can face everything and rise. We can stand secure in spirit. There's a tradition, a rite of passage for young men of the Cherokee Nation. To signify a boy has become a man, the father takes his son into the forest blindfolded. There, the young man is left alone and required to sit on a stump all night long. He's not allowed to remove the blindfold until he feels the rays of the sun hit his face and shine through that blindfold. He is told that he cannot cry out for help. He must survive the night, and then he will have proven that he is a man. According to the tradition, the young men who go through this ritual are not allowed to tell the other young men about the experience. They just cannot share it because each one must come into manhood on his own. Well, of course, I mean, you've got to imagine this is terrifying for that kid as he sits there in the dark through the long, chilly night. I mean, he could hear all kinds of noises and sounds. I mean, no doubt his imagination just goes wild. I mean, what if there's some wild beast out there that's close by and about to get him? And he has no way to protect himself. Oh, I can imagine how much he must wish he could just remove that blindfold or at least, you know, lift up the edge a little bit and take a peek just to reassure himself. But he knows the only way he can become a man is by leaving it on. Finally, after a very long night, the sun appears. The boy has now become a man, and he can now remove the blindfold. It's not until then that he sees his father sitting on the stump right next to him. His father has been there all night on watch, protecting his son from harm. Even in our darkest hours, we are never alone. God is always there. Even in our fear, even in our doubt, the greatest power in the universe is with us, and we can remain secure in spirit. Namaste. And now it is time for our tithes and offerings. And I want you to remember, even though we are not in our beautiful building together, that beautiful building has expenses associated with us. And we need to do our part to keep this church going because it's a beautiful congregation of wonderful people. And so we want to share, we want to give, graciously give, generously give our tithes and offerings. So take your gift in your hand and let's repeat our offertory together. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Amen. And we bless this offering. We bless it. We are so grateful for all the gifts that are coming into this church. We know that everyone believes in the mission of Unity East, and we know that everyone supports the mission of this church. And the church gives so much to each and every one of us, and so much to the community, the surrounding community that we support. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for these gifts, for these tithes, for these generously given offerings. And we appreciate, and what we appreciate grows. Again, we say amen. And with that, it's time for our peace song. And I will now play that. yourself. I can get it to stop. Together, the light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.